on this holy evening, Good Friday. And welcome to our Tenebrae service. Tenebrae is a, well, it's a big word, simply meaning a time of shadows, or service or worship in the shadows. It symbolizes that time leading up to the cross of Christ, that in-between time, the time between Palm Sunday and between Easter. It was first interpreted by James Charlesworth and is based on John 18, verse 1, to chapter 19, verse 42. It has a special sensitivity to Judaism and Jesus' Jewishness, and the origins of Christianity and the Jewish faith are symbolized and are displayed within the service. But as we gather together, it seems a very somber time. But there's one other issue, one other matter. We know the end of the story. If you will look over to the side, our greeting, our call to worship, and our opening prayer will be on the wall, and I don't know if y'all can read it. It looks big enough, but please join me in the greeting. Remain seated. God is light, in whom there is no darkness at all.
Jesus Christ is the light of the world.
And this is the judgment. The light has come into the world.
And who knows the darkness is better than the light.
Almighty God, graciously behold this your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed into the hands of Satan, and to suffer death upon the cross, who now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Jesus went forth with his disciples across the Kidron Valley, where there was a garden which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew this place, for Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas, procuring a band of soldiers and some of the officers from the chief priests and the Pharisees, went there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to befall him, came forward and said to them, "Whom do you seek?" They answered him, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus said to them, "I am he." Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with him. When he said to them, "I am he," they drew back and fell to the ground. Again he asked them, "Whom do you seek?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. So, if you seek me, let these men go." This was to fulfill the word which he had spoken, "I did not lose a single one of those whom you gave me." Then Simon Peter, having a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's slave and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword into its sheath. Shall I not drink the cup which my Father has given me?"
Simon Peter followed Jesus, and so did another disciple. As this disciple was known to the high priest, he entered the court of the high priest along with Jesus. while Peter stood outside at the door. So the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out and spoke to the woman who guarded the gate and brought Peter in. The woman who guarded the gate said to Peter, "Are you not you also one of these man's disciples?" Peter said, "I am not." Now the servants and the officers had made a charcoal fire because it was cold, and they were standing and warming themselves. Peter also was with them, standing and warming himself.
The high priest then questioned Jesus about his disciples and his teaching. Jesus answered him, "I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in synagogues and in the temple, where all Jewish people come together. I have said nothing secretly. Why do you ask me? Ask those who have heard me what I said to them. They know what I said." When he had said this, one of the officers standing by struck Jesus with his hand, saying, "Is this how you answered the high priest?" Jesus answered him, "If I have spoken wrongly, bear witness to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?" Annas then sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest.
Then they led Jesus from the house of Caiaphas to Pilate's headquarters. It was early. They themselves did not enter the headquarters so that they might not be defiled, but might eat the Passover. So Pilate went out to them and said, "What accusation do you bring against this man?" They answered him, "If this man were not an evildoer, we would not have handed him over." Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and judge him by your own law." The religious authorities said to him, "It is not lawful for us to put any man to death." This was to fulfill the word which Jesus had spoken to show by what death he was to die.
Entered the headquarters again and called Jesus and said to him, "Are you king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you say this of your own accord, or did others say it to you about me?" Pilate answered, "Am I a Jew? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingship is not of this world. If my kingship were of this world, my servants would fight that I might not be handed over to the religious authorities. But my kingship is not from this world." Pilate said to him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I have come into the world to bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice." Pilate said to him, "What is the truth?"
They cried out, "Not that this man, but Barabbas." Now Barabbas was a robber.
Then Pilate took Jesus and scourged him. And the soldiers plighted him a crown of thorns and put it on his head and arrayed him in a purple robe. They came up to him, saying, "Hail, the King of the Jews," and struck him with their hands. Pilate went out again and said to them, "See, I am bringing him out to you, that you may know that I find no crime in him." So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, "Behold the man." When the chief priests and the officers saw him, they cried out, "Crucify him, crucify him." Pilate said to them, "Take him yourself and crucify him, for I find no crime in him." The religious authorities answered him, "We have a law, and by that law he ought to die, because he has made himself the Son of God." When Pilate heard these words, he was more afraid. He entered the headquarters again and said to Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave no answer. Pilate therefore said to him, "You will not speak to me? Do you know that I have the power to release you and the power to crucify you?" Jesus answered him, "You have no power over me unless it had been given you from above. Therefore, he who delivered me to you has the greater sin."
These words, he brought Jesus out and sat down on the judgment seat
at a place called the Pavement, and in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation of the Passover. It was about the sixth hour. He said to the religious authorities, "Behold your king." They cried out, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but Caesar." They handed him over to them to be crucified.
So they took Jesus, and he went out, bearing his own cross, to the place called the place of a skull, which is called in Hebrew Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with two others, one on either side, and Jesus between them. Pilate also wrote a title and put it on the cross. It is read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many Judeans read this title, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew and Latin and in Greek. The Jewish chief priest then said to Pilate, "Do not write, 'The King of the Jews,' but 'This man said, I am the King of the Jews,'" Pilate answered. "What I have written, I have written."
So the soldiers did this, but standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing near, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." Then he said to his disciple, "Behold your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her to his own home.
Thank you. Since it was the day of preparation in order to prevent the bodies from remaining on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath was a high day, the religious authorities asked Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once there came out blood and water. He who has saw this has borne witness. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth, and you also may believe. For the things that took place, that the scripture might be fulfilled, not a bone of him shall be broken. And another scripture says, they shall look on him.
After this, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly, for fear of the religious authorities, asked Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus. Pilate gave him leave. So he came and took away his body. Nicodemus also, who had first come to him by night, came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloe, about 100 pounds weight. He took the body of Jesus and bound it in linen cloths with spices, as was the burial custom of the Jews. Now in a place where he was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb where no one had ever been laid. So because of the Jewish day of preparation, as the tomb was close at hand, they laid Jesus there.
Thank you.
Go in peace. May Jesus Christ, who for our sake became obedient unto death, even death on the cross, keep you and strengthen you this night and forever. Amen.